We start our 7-day Ultima Galapagos experience by flying from Quito, Ecuador on Aerogal Airlines to the seaport Gualaquil. From Gualaquil, we fly 600 miles over the ocean until we finally come up to the Galapagos Islands. We land on South Seymour Island, which is right next to Santa Cruz Island. From the airport, we take a short trip on a local bus to catch a ferry to Santa Cruz Island. Here we first meet our tour guide, who is also a certified naturalist for their National Park Services. We take a charter bus all the way across Santa Cruz Island to the port our ship is located at. On our way, we stop at a preserve to see the largest tortoise species in the world, the Galapagos tortoise. They can grow to a size of up to 880 pounds. They can also be more than 6 feet long. This tortoise has a very high shell that is brown and light green in color. It blends extremely well with their surroundings. They can quickly place their head and appendages into that shell when they are hot or they feel that they're in danger. The shell is very large and is very bony. The Galapagos tortoise may spend several hours each morning basking in the sunlight. They move at a very slow and leisurely pace. Many would get the impression that they're very lazy creatures, but this is all part of them being able to maintain energy and to keep their body temperatures where it should be. They have a very low metabolism, which is the case for all species of the tortoise. Here, a few of us get a chance to climb into a tortoise shell to experience firsthand how it feels with such a heavy weight on your back.
Yeah, there you go.
Oh. Wow. Air gap there. That's impressive.
Oh, he's walking.
This is also a good opportunity for a group photo of our tour group. Over millions and millions of years, nearly all islands in the world were once connected to a huge central landmass called Pangaea. As Pangaea fractured and became continents, smaller fragments of the Earth's crust became islands. However, the Galapagos Islands are an archipelago, a group of islands closely scattered in a body of water. These islands were formed by volcanoes erupting from the ocean floor. These islands never shared a history with a large continental landmass. These islands are truly volcanic islands that are very young in geological time and too removed from mainland for most flora, fauna, as well as animals to make the long journey. The remoteness and geographical isolation allowed the flora and fauna of the Galapagos Islands to develop in a unique way, enabling animals to evolve in their own isolated ecosphere to produce species not found anywhere else in the world. In addition, these islands were further influenced by being at the intersection of three major oceanic currents. These major currents are the Humboldt Current, cold and nutritionally rich, the Panama Current, warm water enabling coral growth, and the Cromwell Current, a cold, upwelling current, particularly in the central islands. After years of isolation on the Galapagos, where small populations of a species must have existed, adaptations within that species would have been more drastic as there was no large mainstream population to act as a buffer for variations. In such a harsh and unforgiving environment, it is difficult to believe that flora and fauna arriving by chance at these islands had any hope to establish a dynasty of descendants. As a result, this is an ideal environment to study microevolution. Charles Darwin's observations, notes, and collected organisms from the Galapagos Islands during his 5-year voyage on the Beagle resulted in his theory of evolution by natural selection, one of the best substantiated theories in the history of science. Darwin's observations, specifically on what are now called Darwin's finches, and their adaptations eventually provided the basis for his theory of natural selection. At the time, it was a dynamic departure from the commonly held belief that species were static. Now it's time to board the ship that we will be on for the next 7 days cruising around the Galapagos Islands. We take two small zodiacs out to our ship. The name of our ship is the Carina. The Carina has 8 large guest cabins for the 14 of us. The rooms are nice, and the cabin attendant adds a special touch by rearranging our stuff on the bed each night. There's a crew of 9, including the cooks, the cabin attendant, the first officer, the naturalist, our tour guide, the captain, the engineer, and the 2 attendants. We take a quick tour of the ship's galley and watch the chef prepare the next meal. We did have excellent meals on this trip, including cow tongue and other South American specialties. Next, we take a tour of the ship's bridge with the captain. Sue gets an opportunity to steer the ship as the captain takes over due to the weather. Here is the ship's radar that has a broad look around us, including detecting the rain. This is the ship's sonar depth indicator to keep us from hitting the bottom. The ship tows these two zodiacs so we can use them for both dry and wet landings and also for sightseeing excursions. Here's an example of a dry landing where we don't have to get our feet wet. However, some of the excursions require us to get out into the water. Here is a map of the islands we will be exploring for the next 7 days. Remember, we started off flying in from Gualaquil to the airport on South Seymour Island. Next, we took a bus ride across Santa Cruz to the port of Aurora, where our ship is located. On Santa Cruz, we toured the Tortoise Reserve. That night, our ship will go up the coast of Santa Cruz to the island of South Plaza for a 2-hour hike. After lunch, our ship goes to Santa Fe Island for deep water snorkeling and another sightseeing trek. The next night, we will cruise south to Floriana Island to Cormorant Point. The next morning, we will go for another sightseeing tour and deep water snorkeling. After lunch, we go to Post Office Bay to drop off a few postcards and to see the Baroness Lookout Point. The next day, we cruise east to Suarez Point off of Espinola Island for more exploring. After that, we take a quick trip over to Gardiner Bay, where there is a beautiful white sandy beach, and we snorkel right off the beach to a nearby reef island. The next day, we go to San Cristobal Island to visit the Interpretation Center. After that, we go to Cerro Brujo for a sightseeing zodiac cruise. From there, we visit Kicker Rock for the best deep water snorkeling on the trip. We cruise all night long to Black Turtle Cove off the coast of Santa Cruz Island. The next morning, we take a zodiac ride in this cove to see numerous manta rays. After lunch, we cruise to North Seymour Island for more deep water snorkeling and a hike. The next day, we go to Bacchus Beach off the coast of Santa Cruz Island. After lunch, we go to Dragon Hill to see the largest iguanas in the world. And finally, 7 days later, we end back up where we started at, the port of Aurora in Academy Bay off the shore of Santa Cruz Island. We start exploring the Galapagos Islands, and one of the first animals you will encounter when landing on a beach are the Galapagos sea lions. These are a species of sea lions that exclusively breed on the Galapagos Islands. Being fairly social, and one of the most numerous species in the Galapagos archipelago, they are often seen sunbathing on sandy shores, are rock groups, are gliding gracefully through the surf. Their loud bark, playful nature, and graceful agility in the water makes them the welcoming party on the islands. There are about 50,000 of them in the Galapagos Islands, but it seems like there are a lot more than that since we run into them on every corner. Here is one that jumped into our ship last night as Sue attempts to get close enough for a photo with it. Sea lions are marine mammals which belong to the superfamily pinnipeds, are fin-footed mammals like the walrus and the seals. Sea lions are characterized for having external ears and large frontal flippers that enables them to walk on land using their four flippers. Galapagos sea lions regularly form large colonies on sandy beaches. Males are highly territorial, particularly during the mating season, which runs from May to December. Galapagos sea lions are frequently very inquisitive and playful in the water, as this one sees my camera lens to get a closer look. They are very curious and swim straight towards you to see what you are doing. As a result, they make great companions while snorkeling. Here I am in a school of yellow-tailed sturgeons when, out of the blue, a sea lion comes up and kisses my lens. During deep water snorkeling at Kicker Rock, I notice a sea lion coming straight towards me. The sea lions make bubbles from deep below as the bubbles make their way up to the surface. This curious sea lion makes its rounds to each of the snorkelers, and my camera lens gets another kiss. They feed during the day, and this one caught a beautiful rainbow parrotfish as it thrashes in the water to break it up into bite-sized pieces. One morning I got up early and went up to the ship's sun deck and noticed a large group of dolphins swimming right next to us. Here are two of them jumping in unison. Now here are three jumping together. Our excursion on Floriana Island, we visit the post office bay. This is where you drop off postcards to your family back in the States in this barrel. Then, when tourists visit this island, they go through the postcards in this barrel and look for ones in their hometown. They pick up a few postcards, and when they return back home, they hand deliver them to the address on the card. We took one for the St. Louis, Missouri area and delivered it last summer when we were visiting St. Louis. The card we dropped off in May was hand delivered the next January to my mother in St. Louis, 8 months later. It is a little slower than the U.S. Postal Service, but it's free.
Maddie and Brian, we're bringing your card to you.
Note that this island also had the mysteries of the Lost Baroness. Here we are on Espanola Island on one of our land excursions where there's a large population of the Nazca booby and the albatross. The albatross and the Nazca boobies are very large birds and use these cliffs to aid them in taking off for flight. These cliffs also make a nice group photo. We take a few moments to watch the surf break on these rocks. On the same island, we cruise over to Gardner Bay, where there's a beautiful white sandy beach. The sea lions are there to greet us. That small reef island ahead was a perfect place to snorkel, and we encountered a few reef sharks. To get on and off this beach requires a wet landing as I get into the Zodiac to head back to the ship. Here we are in the back of the ship with our wetsuits on, getting ready to board the Zodiacs for some exciting snorkeling. This is one of the underwater cameras I used on this trip, a Black Edition GoPro Hero 3 Plus. On our 7-day cruise of the Galapagos Islands, we had a chance to snorkel twice a day. To me, this was the highlight of the trip, where we were able to swim with all the exotic animals, even the sharks and the manta rays. Doug swims down deep to get a close-up of this reef. As you can see, it's easy to float in the salt water without the need of any life preserver. Also, the naturalist and the Zodiac crew are watching you to make sure you're not drowning or being eaten by a shark. Snorkeling also has the advantages when it rains, you're already wet, and doesn't make that much difference when you're under the water anyway. Sue is all excited from the sea lion that swam right between her legs. During this deep water excursion, I found a spotted eagle ray directly below me. It glides so effortlessly through the water, it looks like it is in slow motion. The spotted eagle ray has pointed head, long tail with a spiny termination, and a wingspan ranging from 3 to 6 feet. However, their most distinguishing feature is the array of white spots that cover their black tops. As this one swims off, another one comes from the depths below. Directly ahead, I can barely make out something coming straight towards me. At first, I couldn't tell what it is, and then I could see it's another spotted eagle ray with its tail broken off. The tail is used for defense and normally has up to 7 barbed spines. While the rays usually shy away from humans, the venomous spines can be dangerous if the ray is provoked. Here are a couple of smaller spotted eagle rays in a quiet lagoon in Black Turtle Cove off the north coast of Santa Cruz Island. In the same lagoon, we come across a school of golden rays. They get their names from their golden colored tops. They swim very close to the surface, and when their wingtips break the surface, it can look spooky. However, you can distinguish them from sharks because rays have 2 fins side by side breaking the water. As we get an underwater view, you can see their blunt heads and long whip-like tail. They have large eyes right in front of their massive gills. Golden rays range in size, but they are usually between 1.5 to 3 feet across the wings. Rays have a brain weight relative to body size that comes close to that of mammals and is about 10 times that of bony fish. We watch these golden rays swim peacefully on their way.
Oh.
On this reef, I spot a Galapagos shark. Sharks come in many different shapes and sizes, but people are most familiar with the classical look of the Galapagos shark. Its body is solid, large, and torpedo-shaped, an efficient form for swimming. Dark gray above and lighter below, the Galapagos shark has no distinctive markings except for a ridge that runs between its dorsal fins. If threatened by a predator or competitor, the shark arches its back, lowers its pectoral fins, and swims in figure-eight loops. If the intruder doesn't heal this display, the Galapagos shark will chase and attack the intruder. Here in deep water, the sharks typically swim near the bottom. Down below, you can see two of them coming towards me. Sharks are often misunderstood. They're not the maniacal eating machines, eager to devour anything or everything in their path. Only about 30 of the approximate 350 species of sharks are dangerous, and even those rarely attack humans. Here's a shark coming from the surface. It must have provided a scare for one of my fellow snorkelers. As it swims deeper, it joins up with a group of six other sharks as they explore the ocean floor. These two sharks swim directly below me as I try to keep up with them. A shark's nose is super sensitive to some odors. It can detect blood in a concentration of only one part per million, the same as one teaspoon of blood in an average-sized swimming pool. Here are seven sharks swimming deep below me as they fade into the cavernous waters. During deep water snorkeling, we encounter our first sea turtles. We see many of them swimming below us. I try to stay right above them to get a better look. Our snorkeling party is getting many close-up photos of these beautiful sea turtles. The Galapagos sea turtles is a subspecies of the green sea turtle that nests almost exclusively in the Galapagos Islands. It is smaller than other green sea turtles, with adults averaging a shell length of 3 feet and a weight of 240 pounds. Its shell is more domed than those of other sea turtles and is darker in color, ranging from dark gray to black. However, these turtles seem to be lighter in hue and are very colorful. Here I am in shallow water when I come across another Galapagos sea turtle. It is swimming towards the shore when it sees me and decides to turn back. I swim over to get a closer look, but the undercurrents from the surf thrust me too close to the turtle. I try to stay back, concerned that I'm only a few inches from her mouth and she will turn and bite me. It takes the Galapagos sea turtle quite some time, 25 years or more, to reach adulthood. Once they reach full size, they can spend the remainder of their lifetime, as long as 100 years in total, roaming the ocean floor. They travel vast distances to return to their breeding grounds, off the shore of the Galapagos Islands, only every 2 to 3 years. Once the female has successfully bred, they can lay as many as 9 individual clutches of eggs in a single season without needing to breed again. Like all sea turtles, the female Galapagos sea turtle returns to the beaches where her life begins to lay her own eggs. On one of our excursions, we saw the tracks made by a female to lay eggs in the sand. These nests are marked by the environmentalists so they can study the population decline. When the baby turtles are hatched, they dig out of their pit and make a run for their lives to the water. However, multiple predators, including crabs and flocks of gulls, ferociously prey on the hatchings during this short scamper. The sea offers safety from birds, crabs, and mammals, but the hatchings are still heavily preyed upon by fish. Only one turtle out of 1,000 will successfully make it to the water and become an adult. Here we are on Santa Fe Island to visit one of the two species of land iguanas in the Galapagos Islands. These land iguanas are large, more than 3 feet long, with males weighing up to 30 pounds. They live in the drier areas of the islands and in the mornings are found sprawled beneath the hot Ecuadorian sun. To escape the heat of the midday sun, they seek the shade of cactus, rocks, trees, and other vegetation. At night, they sleep in burrows dug in the ground to conserve their body heat.
Galapagos.
Land iguanas reach maturity between 8 and 15 years of age. Males are territorial and will aggressively defend specific areas that typically include more than one female. They feed mainly on low-growing plants and shrubs, as well as fallen fruits and cactus pads. These succulent pads provide them with the moisture they require during long, dry periods. Here's a male and female iguana sharing a cactus pad until the female decides she wants it all for herself.
It got it!
Smart. Must have been a woman.
Now this female is joined by another more aggressive female that steals it and runs off with the cactus pad. However, a large male sees this going on and decides he wants it all for himself. The female doesn't put up a fight and lets him have his way for now. Now we are on a hike on North Seymour Island when I come across a land iguana on my path.
Do they bite?
It will jump and bite your leg. Be careful.
Thank you for telling me that.
Apparently, they are harmless. Following the mating period, female iguanas find suitable nesting sites, dig their nesting burrows, and lay between 2 to 20 eggs. The female defends the burrow for a short time to prevent other females from nesting in the same place. The young iguanas hatch 3 to 4 months later and take about a week to dig their way out of the nest. If they survive the first difficult years of life, when food is often scarce and predators are a danger, land iguanas can live more than 50 years. This land iguana spits excessive salt water out of his nose. Now we are on Santa Cruz Island at Dragon Hill. This hill is named after the largest iguanas in the Galapagos Islands. There is only a small colony left, as local dogs and cats have destroyed most of the iguana population here over the years when Santa Cruz was settled by humans and their pets. This iguana is a male. You can tell a male iguana from being larger and more colorful and having a larger crown running down from his head to his back. In fact, the male's body gets more colorful during mating season to attract females. This iguana is a female. It has a smaller crown and is not as colorful. Here are the marine iguanas. As you can see, they are much smaller than the land iguanas and are mostly dark gray, with the males having red patches. These red patches grow larger and brighter during mating season to attract the females. The marine iguanas are only found on the Galapagos Islands, and they often wear a distinctive white wig of salt expelled from glands near their nose. Scientists figure that land-dwelling iguanas from South America must have drifted out to sea millions of years ago on logs or other debris, eventually landing on the Galapagos Islands. From that species emerged marine iguanas, which spread to nearly all the islands in the Galapagos archipelago. Each island hosts marine iguanas of unique size, shape, and color. They look fierce, but they are actually gentle herbivores, surviving exclusively on underwater algae and seaweed. Their short, blunt snouts and small, razor-sharp teeth help them scrape the algae off the rocks, and their laterally flattened tails let them move crocodile-like through the water. Their claws are long and sharp for clinging to rocks on shore or underwater in heavy currents. They have dark gray coloring to better absorb sunlight after their ventures into the frigid Galapagos waters. And they even have special glands that clean their blood of extra salt, which they ingest while feeding. Their population is estimated to be in the hundreds of thousands. However, they are undergoing constant pressure from non-native predators like rats, cats, and dogs who feed on their eggs and young. They are protected throughout the archipelago and are considered vulnerable to extinction. The Galapagos Islands are home to three very interesting birds, the Naza booby, the red-footed booby, and the blue-footed booby, three of the Earth's six species of boobies. The name booby is derived from the Spanish word bobo, meaning clown, after which they are named because of their strange ways and colorful attributes. Boobies range from 25 to 36 inches in length, with a wingspan of 3 to 5 feet. All nest close to the ocean and even close to each other, yet don't compete for food or territory because they have different habitats. They all lay eggs, the number varies, and they use their webbed feet to warm the eggs once they have been laid. The blue-footed booby is the most distinguishable of the species, with its bright turquoise blue feet. As with all boobies, the male can be distinguished by their voices. They have a pleasant whistle. Additionally, it is easy to distinguish the female blue-footed booby because of the dark ring of pigmentation around her pupil. Just like the other boobies, they fish for food, but each species has their own fishing habits. As they dive, they hit the ocean straight on with immense force and have air sacs in their skulls that help with the impact. This activity stands out most with the blue-footed boobies, as they have longer tails, which helps them to steer quickly and get out of the dive. This allows them to dive up to 80 feet above the ocean and even into less than 2 feet of water. The blue-footed boobies fish close to the shore and enjoy sardines and squid. The famous booby dance is part of the amazing courtship ritual in which boobies practice. The male walks around the female, raising his bright blue feet straight up in the air while bringing his shoulders towards the ground and crossing the bottom tips of his wings high above the ground. Plus, he'll raise his bill up towards the sky, sky pointing, to try to win over his mate. The female may also participate in these activities, lifting her feet, sky pointing, and of course, squawking at her mate. However, in this case, the male fails to impress the female, as she walks off thinking she can do better. Nature has a cruel reality. However, for the lucky ones, after mating, another ritual occurs, building the nest, which ironically is never used because the nest is on the bare ground. They will trade off placing twigs or stones on the ground or giving them to one another. When the eggs are ready to be laid, the nest is pushed away and a ring of excrement is made around the nesting area, which specifies their nesting territory to others. The blue-footed boobies nest all year round, unlike the others. Another difference is that they may lay up to 3 eggs, which are incubated by both the male and the female, and raise all 3 chicks if the food supply is adequate. All 3 boobies are similar in size, but the mast booby is the largest, with a wingspan of over 5 feet. The Naza booby, also known as the white or mask booby, nests on the ground. They are often around cliffs where they can take advantage of gravity by getting assistance from taking off into flight, which they will need since they are the biggest, heaviest boobies. The Naza booby catches fish in deep waters. Naza boobies lay 2 eggs several days apart, and yet after they hatch, they both won't survive. These are one of the only birds in the world that practice siblicides, the killing of a sibling regardless of the food supply. After they are hatched, the chicks compete for food, and the strongest, oldest chick usually survives by shoving the youngest chick out of the nest. While still in eyesight of the mother, and not receiving food and being scorched by the equatorial sun, the weakest one dies. If the older chick dies, then the younger one was stronger, and this process continually improves the breed. There are more red-footed boobies than the others in the Galapagos. This is the smallest of all boobies, ranging from 25 to 30 inches long, and is the only one to construct twig nests up to 4 feet high in trees and shrubs. The red-footed booby has a different breeding habit as well, laying only 1 egg and raising that chick. Red-footed boobies are very sensitive to changes in their food supply. If they are unable to find ample amounts of food, they are known to abandon their eggs or chicks. On the other hand, when food supplies are plentiful, they are known to feed their chicks well past the fleeting stage. Here on North Seymour Island, we visit the largest colonies of Galapagos frigate birds in the world. They catch the updraft off the ocean breeze as they float just over our heads. Just look at how many of them there are. The male, female, and immature plumages are distinctly different, and breeding males have a bright red gular pouch that is inflated during courtship. Here you can see the bright red pouch makes it difficult for the male birds to maneuver when flying, especially in a strong breeze. It looks like they're carrying a big red balloon under their beaks. Here is one ready to land, and we can take a closer look at this big red pouch on the ground. We walk around and find some other males showing off their pride and joy, trying to attract a mate. Just look at this one. Wow. Frigate birds are large, dark seabirds with very long, pointed wings which are held forward from their shoulder in flight. They have deeply forked tails and short legs with webbed feet. Their bills are long and hooked-tipped. Frigate birds soar high over the sea and feed by harassing, and kleptoparasiting other seabirds, particularly boobies, are by picking food directly from the surface of the sea. However, they never land on water as they lack the oil-secreting gland which keeps their feathers of seabirds dry and would otherwise drown. In this nest is a juvenile frigate bird. Frigate birds are seasonally monogamous and nest colonially. A rough nest is constructed in low trees. As you can see, this one is only about 3 feet above the ground. A single egg is laid each breeding season, and the young bird doesn't leave the nest for 18 months. If the parents don't come back to feed it, it will die. If the wind blows the bird out of its nest, it will die because it can't take off from the ground. Here we are on the west side of Espanola Island, where the largest colony of wave albatross, also known as the Galapagos albatross, lives. We happen to arrive during the courtship season, as most of these birds are going through their mating rituals. The courtship of the Galapagos albatross is very elusive and a spectacular sight. It includes rapid bill circling and bowing, beak clacking, and an upraised bill to make a woo-hoo sound. The male chases the female around until she gets so tired that she has to stop to catch her breath. This is when the male makes his move. This lasts about a minute, and then the female chases him off again. After the chase, they both engage in beak clacking that looks a lot like they are kissing. It seems like they have the courtship process backwards, but it seems to work for them. The eggs are laid between April and June and incubated for 2 months by either the male or the female. Here is one being incubated now. The partners remain mates until one of the partners dies. The Galapagos albatross are spectacular flyers, perhaps the most famous. They can fly for hours without stalling, and they do this by dynamic soaring. In this illustration, there's a side wind as shown with the moving arrows. The Galapagos albatross uses this to its advantage by gliding at speeds into the wind. Exposed to a headwind, the speed of the air over its wings increases, which produces lift, and the albatross gains height while maintaining airspeed, but with a loss of some ground speed. When it gets high enough, it turns and dives back down with the wind to gain both airspeed and ground speed. So by repeating this S-curve pattern, the bird can continue flying almost indefinitely without having to put in much effort. However, albatross do have difficulty in landing due to their high stalling speed, and in taking off due to the challenge of beating their massive wings. As a result, the albatross likes to take off by jumping off of a cliff into a wind, as this one is about to do. The Sally Lightfoot crab is also known as the sandy crab or red lava crab. They are often found on the Galapagos Islands, hanging with the marine iguanas. Young crabs are dark colored and blend in well with the lava rock they are found. Adults vary in color from reddish brown to bright red with bits of pink, yellow, and blue. Really, the rainbow's the limit. The crabs are very quick on their feet and hard to catch. The Galapagos pelicans are considered to be an endemic subspecies of the brown pelican. This one is not brown yet because it is a juvenile. Pelicans are very large, heavy water birds with short legs, webbed feet, and an exceptionally long bill with a wingspan of nearly 5 feet. The bill has a large, discernible pouch which is used as a scoop net to catch fish. For feeding purposes, the Galapagos pelican hits the water with its beak open, the wings extended, but its tail and two large feet never penetrate the water. In flight, pelicans hold their head and neck drawn back and have slow, rather ponderous wing beats. They are, however, accomplished gliders. Pelicans are very ungangly on land, rarely walking very far, and the sexes are alike. The Galapagos Islands are host to the second smallest penguins in the world, next to the little penguins in Australia. Galapagos penguins are endemic to the Galapagos Islands. It is the only penguin that lives north of the equator in the wild. Populations fluctuate heavily under the influence of climate change like El Nino, introduced species like cats and dogs, and by diseases and natural predators to a degree that the future survival of the species is endangered. In fact, this one we saw is injured and is not likely to survive the night. In a lagoon on Santa Cruz Island, we come across some flamingos as they take off right in front of us. While snorkeling, we encounter numerous fish. These are yellowtail surgeons pecking away at the algae on the rocks below. I am swimming with a school of yellowtail surgeons and amazed that they let me join in. Here's a lava reef that I cruise over for some close-ups. I come across a hieroglyphic hawkfish. Swimming out to a coral reef, I spot an octopus below me. I see a massive swarm of large-eyed bream fish and decide to swim in the middle of them. They separate and let me get inside, and now I have a ring of fish 360 degrees around me. Quite remarkable, they stay in this formation until I swim out. This yellow-tailed damsel is very territorial. It is such a little fish, but it will not give ground to me. See how it defends its habitat? Here is a Galapagos ring-tailed damsel fish. These are Galapagos surgeon majors and they won't stay still for a photo. This puffer fish won't stay still either. This beautiful rainbow parrotfish is similar to the one we saw the sea lion eating the other day. Here's a reef triggerfish swimming along the bottom of this reef. And this is some kind of dragonfish that is hiding from me. This was our ultimate Galapagos experience. The Galapagos Islands are like no other place in the world. All the wildlife is unafraid of humans, which makes it quite remarkable and allows close-up photos with these unique animals. We saw the blue-footed boobies. Swam with the Galapagos sharks. Went to Dragon Hill to see the largest iguanas in the world. Snorkeled with the manta rays. Watched male frigate birds showing off. And then there were the curious sea lions. What a wonderful vacation experience.